Thank you. Would you please welcome on stage Angus Macaulay, Oisín's brother on the fiddle.
The bull fiddle.
This next song that we're going to do is like our lucky song at the moment, and it's a song that's very special to us. It was written by Tommy Sands, and it's all about what it was like for him growing up in Ross Trevor when he was a young fella, and it's called The County Down. So we'll give it a go for you.
When you're out walking and there's no one near you, but a voice keeps calling, you hear your name. It's not the leaves or the whispering breezes, it's me that's calling. Can you hear me? Oh, can you hear me? As you roam through lonely London town, when evening's falling, you'll hear me calling. Come on home now to the county down. Do fiddlers playing the songs and stories the whole night long. 'Tis little than that you thought of leaving. It seems so strange now that you are gone. Oh, can you? The fish are dancing on Clanry River. The teams are sporting in Old Glenbeg. My heart no longer can leave the cheering when you're not playing. Things are changing, and that they're building a factory tall. And young men needed again in Newry, but I still need you the most of all. Oh, can you? Roam through lonely London town.
very much.
Thanks to Angus again there.
We're going to play a couple of tunes that came from the playing of Tommy Peebles and John Doherty, who are two great fiddle players who come from Donegal.
We're going to continue on now with three reels, and the first tune is a tune called the Fairy Reel, and it's amazing, you could hear this tune anywhere in the world, and they play it in Cape Breton, I think, they do, and they play it wherever they play tunes, they play it a lot of places. And the second tune then is a tune called the Old Torn Petticoat, and it's something I wouldn't know anything about, and I don't want to know anything about. And the last tune is a lovely tune called Our House at Home, and I got it from the playing of Brian McNamara. So, here we go. And I hope my pipes are in tune now, so we'll see.
Thank you.
Mr. Jonathan Goff from the pipes.
Thank you.
Margaret. Thank you.
We'd like to welcome John Sheehan to the stage if we can, please.
Yes, the generation gap. Since I walked on the stage, the average age of this ensemble here has gone up dramatically. But just an example, a living example of the, when I mentioned the generation gap here, we started off around 1962, the Dubliners, and also the Clancy brothers and Tommy Makem. And here I am on the stage now with the son of Liam Clancy, it's Donald Clancy over here. So there you are. We played very late one night in Tondor. It was nearly dawning on us, I think. And the first one, what's the name of the first one, Benny? The Wonder Hornpipe. I'm just checking to make sure we're playing the same tunes here. The Wonder Hornpipe. And the second one is a little tune I wrote as a kind of an experiment to incorporate some kind of jazzy chords. Are they called demented? Diminished, sorry. to incorporate some diminished chords with a traditional type of a structure. I called it the impish hornpipe. That's the second one. But we'll start with the first one, will we? Yeah. Well, if we remember, yeah. We're out there, rush in. One, two.
Mr. John Sheehan, ladies and gentlemen. Please give it up.
I'm going to do a song for you now from beautiful West Kerry. And this is a song from an island called the Great Blasket Island. And it's a beautiful place altogether, but unfortunately nobody living there anymore. It was evacuated about 50 years ago. And this song is called Banacht Orina Hina, which translates as a blessing from the King of Fridays. And in this song, it's one of the islanders, and he's blessing the island and all the people on it before he leaves. Banacht Orina Hina Lonin in a fellow Margamar lies here, nobly near Malu town. This song of you can really could be by its lounger claw. It's lonely and garden be hooved, dollier than brown the bar. I roig mission out of spagum log on the corner of day. Neon meg an old chow, go broth their fag mohe. Marche the horot log, the rog is the var of may. Is good dinus all gone by? Tall on the mascara blade. There in a glass and old we, I am storing Shadiakas too. Me as the Hashim Rogin is bro, yes, the lagan too. No ruin. Struan of Lonion Foss the Shin, a wandling dollar. Thank you. Well, I hope you're in the form for some dancing. I don't know how much space you have there, but sure, you can clap your hands and see what happens. We're going to start off with a couple of West Kerry tunes, a polka called Nelly. If anybody knows it, you can sing along. I know there's a few heads down there who know the words of that one. And then we continue on with a great polka from the States called Dan Sullivan's Shamrock Swing Band that I got from my dad, who's down there somewhere. And then we continue on with a slide that Tom here wrote for his son, and it's called Dane Thomas's. And we finish up with a rousing tune called Jazzin' with Mag Leary, and you never know what might happen then. ¶¶ Mr. Des Dillon and Peggy.
And back to the stage again, Mr. Angus McCauley.
Mr. Angus McCauley there on cello.
The brother.
Are you ready? Well, are you ready for another blast of reels there? Are you ready? This next set of reels starts off with a tune called Are You Ready Yet? And it was written in County Galway. Hello. On one of those lovely tropical days all year round. And we were looking for a tune to finish off the set. And we were down in Dunica's pub a few years ago in Mooney's on Rhine. And we were down the cellar looking for... we found an old manuscript of music under a barrel of Guinness. Several. Anne. And there we found this lovely tune called I'm Ready Now. There we go. Stephen McCarthy, yes, another brother on stage, brother of Brendan there, doing a dance for us.
I come from a place called Ring, County Waterford, down around Dungarvan. And A few months ago, there was a very tragic story, very tragic thing happened down there. As you know, around Ireland, there's a lot of building going on, and they happened to be knocking down this lovely old cottage. I thought it was a shame myself, knocking down this lovely thatched cottage. But anyway, whilst knocking it down, they found a skeleton up in the attic of the cottage. And of course, the Gardaí were called, and the coroner was called, and when they were removing this skeleton, this lovely gold chain fell off the skeleton's neck. And they cleaned it off and dusted it off, and written on the chain was the All England Hide and Go Seek Champion 1975. So I'm going to play this little tune for him. And I hope you enjoy it.
Thank you. off on the pipes.
And Margaret.
Thanks.
Donach and I are going to do a tune together now, just the two of us, or a song, I should say. We're thinking of like heading off as a duet, you know, or duo. And this is a song that...
It looks so.
Bye! You can stay if you want. This is a song, it's an old Irish song, the air of which I believe was written by Etna Níl Na Chán, and the words which are very old, and it's called Mali na Goch ni Chulinon, and otherwise sometimes known as His Father Lim Umi. And it's a very, very sad song. It's about this young fella, and he's heartbroken because he was going out with this beautiful woman and she left him. And not only did she leave him alone and heartbroken, but she had plenty of money and used to buy him a lot of drink. And now he has no drink and no girlfriend. And he's very sad.
I know the feeling myself. We're going to do this for Frank Hart down there.
Ermeshgan ni hem ni smo Rhaelanan gado ni blashame O chael me mochalim biogog Dachirach im fok in targud Is fadil am ummi Is fadil am ummi odimik shi Is fadil am hisagus husi Malin guach ni chilinor Diarem tiger nor Is bekerem abon e brekegon Ni ligig men din e dogor Gadukoch malog ni chilinor Is fadil am ummi ummi Is fadil am ummi odimik shi His father loved me, Sagas Husi. Malin Guach Nichilinor. The Menschen Achir Vosh. Is Nadin Iran Aftokinas. Nienet Mahomna Gobra. Gadukoch Malbon Nichilinor. His father loved me. His father loved me, oh, Dimmick she. His father loved me, Sagas Husi. Malin Guach Nichilinor. Visa her Huil. Is the whole of them see she rather good. You know she marvon beyond. No buchel as old and tender. His father loved me, ummi. His father loved me, oh, Dimmick she. His father loved me, Sagas Husi. Malin Guach Nichilinor. His father loved me, Sagas Husi. Malin Guach Nichilinor.
That's Mr. Donal Clancy on guitar over there.
Thank you. And this is the rest of the band to my right. Donnacha Goff on the pipes and the bower on. And of course, Benny McCarthy here on my right.
We're Nick Howler from County Kerry. Woo!
Oisín Macaulay on the fiddle. Woo!
I don't have the blonde hair now. Calm down. To my right, from Glenageary, County Dublin, Mr. Tom Durley on the flute.
Thank you very much. And also from Glenageary, County Dublin, without glasses, Eamon Dourley on bouzouki.
Jesus, it's all of us, aren't there?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Good night. God bless.
Thanks very much. Thanks for coming out. It's out.
We're Mila, Mila Mahagav. You've been an amazing audience tonight. We've had a fantastic gig here, so thanks so much for coming out. And hopefully we'll be back before too long. This is a song by Richard Thompson called Farewell, Farewell. It's good night from all of us. Thanks.
Would be lovely now. How about if we got Phil Cunningham and John Sheehan and all these people from behind the stage, or Angus?
We had a very pleasant surprise there.
Sharon interval. Shannon is there someplace, and all these people out for a couple of tunes. What do you think?
Great to have another girl up on the stage at the very end of the night.
Might give us a hand clapping along with this one. It's an old favourite of ours.
Night, God bless.
This next song I'm going to do for you is an old-timey American song, and I learned it from a singer and fiddler called Bruce Molsky, who lives in upstate New York. And it's a song called Peg and Doll, and it's all about making shoes. And then along came the Industrial Revolution.
Continue now with a couple of jigs. The first jig, which was written by a friend of ours, Noel Ryan, and he wrote it for his mother. And some of you might have heard the story about Noel, but he was very bad to get up every morning. So his mother decided to sort this out with a bunch of nettles up to his bedroom. And he wrote a tune then, and he called it Peggy's Nettles. Thank you.
Margaret. Thank you. Could you please welcome on stage Phil Cunningham? That's what you call the full Monty.
It's the wrong way round for you this way. I learned this piece of music from my friends here when we met in Canada, or Canada, as we like to call it, French Canada. And I'm very happy to be on stage with Danu, because I thought she'd given up music after her presidential election campaign. You've got no idea how much that hurts. I'm going to play a tune for you that the boys taught me when we first met in Canada. Cape Breton, and the only time I ever play it really is when they're around, so it's now known as Danu Boy. I sometimes play it in the house for myself just to cheer myself up, but yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I was in school with Donica and Donald, probably from the age of, you know, 13, 14 on. And we got an invitation, I think at Halloween time or something, to go to Germany to play it.
You've been asked to play in Germany, that was a huge thing. And I remember coming back on the airplane, we had our instruments with us, and the air hostess got us to take out our instruments and go up to the front of the plane and play some music up 33,000 feet. She was giving us free beer. I'll never forget it.
Back in 1994, the Oireachtas, which is the national Chano singing competition, yearly event, was held in Dungarvan.
Benny and myself and Donica were in there playing, I think, one night at a Cayley, and we were joined by some lads who came down from Dublin. I think the Dooralees were there, Tom and Eamon, and Dara Bracken was on fiddle.
And the organiser then for Lorion, Tomás MacRory, he was... It was just at the Cayley, like, and he came up and asked us then if we'd like to go to Lorion the following summer in 1995.
So we gave our friend Dara Bracken a call, and he was up for it, he agreed to do it. So the four of us headed off as Danu, and we played the festival in France. And
all young musicians from all around, Galicia, Brittany, England, Scotland, Wales.
Hugely successful, we had a great time. Invited back the next year, and we were allowed to expand the size of the band. And I remember the evening before we went to France to the festival, we had a session in Dublin with Tom and Eamon Dooralee.
Myself and Don and Benny and Dara said to Tom and Eamon, Jesus, if we're invited back next year, we'll ask you to come along, or you come along. And sure enough, we were invited back the following year.
I couldn't make it to the next year to Lorient. So they had to get a replacement for me.
So the six of us travelled over for 10-11 days, had a fantastic time, crazy time, and came home and we recorded an album just for the fun of it, because it went so well for us, and we won a prestigious award at the festival that year for best new band or something like this.
Cordon de Boulet,
and we can't pronounce it, but we went ahead and recorded an album, and next thing the gigs started coming in. And we followed on with the following summer. We did a residency in Galway in the Keys Bar every Monday and Tuesday, and it was just great fun. And we had a laugh, and we were meeting more people, and more gigs were coming in the festivals. And the same summer, we went to the Tuner Festival in southern Denmark, which is perhaps the most prestigious festival in Europe, folk festival. And it kind of kicked off from there.
To see the evolution of the group, they were playing around the floor down in Mooney's pub when Tom and Paddy and I would come home from touring, and Bobby would come down and we'd have a session down in Mooney's, and they were the kids.
We've had a few changes over the last few years in the band. A singer is Cormac McGrath, who was actually Donald's brother-in-law. He sang with us first.
Our first tour of America was in San Francisco, or California really. A great friend of ours, Christiana Wilson, she brought us out there in the Women in Prayer. She had no experience in agency or anything like that.
She kind of started us off actually in America. She just, as a friend, she heard us over in Ireland, and she heard us. She loved us, and she had no experience of being an agent. She brought us out for the fun. And we kind of kicked off from there, and she was great help to us. We wouldn't be touring, I suppose, if it wasn't for her.
Yeah, so when we went out there, you can imagine a bunch of young lads in California. It was quite an incredible experience. I mean, we didn't have a bob between us, but we were out there following our dream, our vision, which I'm not too sure we had one at the time. But
black with a creamy white top in it. That was the only vision we had at the time, I think.
Yeah.
round he lived in the east. His trade it was cutting down brooms, green brooms.
Not too long before I joined the band, Noel Ryan and Jesse Smith had joined the band, and my first gig was in Toner, and it was a real baptism of fire. It was a massive gig in front of a few thousand people. Sure, it was a wicked, daunting experience altogether.
To John goes, he swore he would burn his room, gay room.
And after that, I gave 5 years playing with the band, and I must say they were five of the best years you could ever imagine. We had some brilliant times altogether, and like fantastic friends.
Then we came on board with Shanachie Records, and a great friend of ours, Joe McKenna, who started the ball rolling in that. And well, while we were in America, Donica flew over to New York to have a chat with them, and that's how we...
Richard Nevins and Don Collins and Shanachie.
Yeah, on board with Shanachie.
That was a big thing for us to get a record deal, because it meant that we had distribution around North America and around the world as well.
It's so funny to see a group that you thought of as being totally local. You saw them start off as youngsters down in the corner of the bar down in Mooney's. And the next thing, they're playing the Hollywood Bowl. They're playing Lincoln Center.
I suppose it makes it interesting too, you know what I mean, all the variety of different places that you play.
Sometimes I suppose you end up in a small, miserable venue in the middle of nowhere with 10 people. But sure, you just collect and run.
Apart from playing and travelling, you get to see a lot of fantastic places, you know. I remember one time we did a tour, for an 8-week tour, 2-month tour, and we drove from Boston as far as San Diego and back across to Houston, Texas. And I mean, we didn't care at the time, we were younger than we are.
We're a good bit away from the Grand Canyon, yeah. St. Joan River.
Oh. That's some way.
Oh,
God, jeez. Race runner. I don't think an escort should be.
Part of your sheep into a little
Oshie McCauley, fantastic fiddle player. Ever before he even played with the band, I was good friends with Oshie.
Remember the first time Oshie did a gig with us at Tuner in Denmark in Tent 2, yeah, which is about 4,500 seater.
And to have to go on in front of all those people was a baptism of fire, start and thunder.
I met him behind the stage about half an hour before we were to play. I went for the pipe set with him, and for the minute he took the fiddle into his hand, I knew there wouldn't be any pressure, any strain. He went up on the stage that night and he played as if he was playing in the band for 150 years.
Shortly after I rejoined Danu, my friend Kieran O'Gallivan decided that He was a bit fed up with touring and the travel and all was starting to get to him.
Before I finished up, there was four of us from West Waterford, which was a fantastic thing altogether, you know, and we had Donald back in the group and playing music with Donald all my life, sure, and playing with Donacha and Binny all my life as well.
So it was upsetting for me, I had just joined, and, you know, it was upsetting for all of us. So that was his decision and we respected that. You know, we still meet up all the time for sessions in the pub.
It was a bit of a pity that we didn't get a chance to record an album together at that point, but there's loads of music to be made yet, so I'm looking forward to that somewhere down the line.
After that, after he left, it was very, very difficult to think of anybody who could fill his shoes. First of all, you'd have to be a great singer in the Irish language and the English language, and as well as a great instrumentalist.
When you're out walking and there's no one near you, but a voice keeps calling, you hear your name. It's not.
I met Martin first around Temple Bar, and we were both gigging around the same area. And at the time, I used to see her playing whistle and flute a lot, you know, and I used to play a bit of guitar. So we kind of thought that was what we did, and then we realised that I played the fiddle and she sang as well, you know.
Oh, can you hear me as you roam through lonely London town? When evening's fall,
to the county down.
A friend of mine knew Dara Bracken, who was the fiddler with the lads at the time, and she said, you have to come along and hear this band. So we went to the Harcourt Hotel, and I remember thinking, I'd never seen anything like it. They had these big collardy hats on, and oh, it was great crack. It was a brilliant gig. And then a couple of years later, I became quite friendly with Oisín, playing with him in sessions and in Dublin, and I heard that he had joined Danu then, so that was fantastic news, and everyone was delighted for him. And then maybe a number of years later, Oisín rang me up out of the blue, and I think they were in Oklahoma or somewhere at the time, and I was here in Kerry, and they actually offered me the opportunity to join the band. So I was delighted altogether. I was living in Kerry at the time. I just finished college, and I was kind of undecided as to what I was going to do next. So this was perfect.
As most people know, especially fans of Danu, that we are brothers. We have quite a family resemblance going on. Some people would say I have the edge on Eamon, certainly in years. He'd say he has the edge on me in the good looks department. But
goes without saying.
Well, we always keep our family affairs away from the rest of the band. It's it can get a bit messy if we're fighting and everyone else gets involved. So we don't fight as a rule, we just stay out of each other's hair.
Tom is a great front man and he's a great spokesman, and I think all the rest of us in the band, you know, we learned from Tom.
Have Tom and Eamon in the band, you have two brothers in the band, and I think it adds great stability to the whole thing, because they're a total unit.
Well, growing up in Dublin was interesting. We grew up in the suburbs in Dunleary. Our parents sent us to an all-Irish speaking school, Scolarcon. So that introduced us to the language a bit better, and a bit of the music as well. Our dad, he introduced me to the tin whistle when I was about 7. Back in the 70s, Eamon was a lot younger than me at the time.
I was in a rock band at the time. I was 4, and they used to take us to Coldus. Our parents were big fans of the Bothy Band and Dubliners and Planks and all this kind of thing. They used to go see them a lot when they were dating. I think it kind of subconsciously got into our heads.
Yeah.
So
especially when we'd be at home and playing around Lego and that, Dad would have Planxty on in the background, so it just kind of soaked it all up. Planxty, Elvis, and Wagner.
Wagner.
That's the diet of music we had Wagner. When we were growing up.
So. Mam is a great fan of Big Tom. She's from Glenamalee and she's a big fan of his.
Yeah. I play the blackbird, the stack of barley, Rodney's glory and the foggy dew. She sang each note.
I know that in Tom and Eamon's family there have there's loads of music and musicians. In particular, their uncle Malachy from Glenamalee, who was a great singer.
She wore no jewels, no costly diamonds, no paints nor powder, oh, none at all. She wore.
Eamon's a great bouzouki player. In many ways, my favourite ever to lift a bouzouki, you know. But he's also a great fiddle player, which a lot of people don't know, which is his first instrument. And he still plays. He's playing more now than he was for the last couple of years. You know, his touring is fairly heavy going, and it's hard to keep up two instruments on the road. You know,
we were down at our mother's home, Glenamalee, and we went to our granduncle's house, Martin Garvey, God rest him. And I played a tune on the Two Missile for him, and he got very excited, and he went into the back kitchen and he produced this. A few sticks, hollowed out sticks with spider's web and old paint in them, and he said, "There you go, bye. There you go, have that now. That was my father's." And it was his father's flute. So we learned then that there had been music in the family for years. Our grandfather played flute and fiddle. His name was Jaw. Great grandfather, sorry. Jaw was his name.
Jaw Garvey, and nobody knows why he was called Jaw to this day.
Yep.
But our grandmother, Katie Garvey, she played the melodeon, and we never knew this until we were kind of into our late teens, early 20s, and our mother was given an accordion one day, and the next thing she started lashing tunes out in it, and we couldn't believe this, you know. And she produced these photographs of her mother and her grandparents and everything when they were kids playing music, you know. A lot of people, they kind of laugh when they ask us where we're from, and we say we're from Glenageary, County Dublin, in the suburbs, because it's not associated with traditional music at all.
I actually started singing as a choir boy, and I started doing piano as well for a few years, but never really went back for about 5 years. And then Eamon took up music. Dad brought him down to Coltis on a Saturday morning to a man called Micheál O'Halloo.
Yeah, I was hanging out in the street corners too much. I was 4 and a half, going on 5, I'd say. And I was just getting a bit rowdy at the time. I think I broke a taffet in my neighbour's garden with the football one day, and that was it. It was either that after Coltis for New Missile lessons or after boarding school. So my dad brought me down to the boarding school, and they wouldn't take me, so he brought me back to Coltis, and I went off. I had a few whistle lessons. Mm. We go down there now when we can, and we see people that are 4 or 5 years old, kids starting off like we did, you know, and it's just another generation coming through.
But what we were exposed to then, there's some great characters around, great musicians like Vincent Broderick, for example, and we learned not just music from him orally, but all the stories that he had going with him. And Vincent's from Loughrea, and he was a flute teacher. He taught us Two Missile and flute. For all the touring and travelling we did, it's amazing like where individually we've ended up. I mean, I never thought I'd ever, in my wildest dreams, not be living in Ireland, not married to an Irish colleen. But here I am on another island on the other side of the Atlantic with two boys and a great wife and a fantastic family around me. And yet still, because we're travelling all around, I can still meet up with the boys and the girl and still continue life with Danu as well, which is pretty damn good as it gets. Where did you end up, Eamon?
My uncle here.
grown up in the northwest in County Donegal. The place I grew up in was called Carrick, and it was a fairly musical place growing up. You know, there was an awful lot of musicians used to travel in to play there. People like Joe Burke even was a very frequent visitor, and of course the most famous person associated with Carrick in the current time is John Doherty. You know, he was playing all the time there at that stage. Unfortunately, John died when I was very young, but I did hear him play, you know, and that he was in the house actually in Carrick and that. There were other people around who were really important, an important influence, I suppose, on myself. People like James Byrne, you know, who used to come in and play all the time in Doc's Bar in Carrick, and the Sleeve League, as it was known, or we knew it as Maloney's. Great places for tunes, just great memories of tunes. Another man, Dermot McLaughlin, used to come down, a Derryman, who's a great, great fiddle player. Nowadays, it's got a thriving teaching scene, and, you know, there's a lot of young people keeping the flag flying for Donegal fiddle music, you know. Four members of Danny were born in the Gaeltacht, the Irish-speaking areas in Ireland, and that being myself, Murren, Donal, and Donica, and six of us speak Irish fluently, you know, and do so frequently. You'd meet a lot of people on the road in Ireland playing music that speak Irish. For example, a friend of mine who I'm playing with at the moment, a fellow called Tony Byrne, from Dublin, he'd be a very keen Irish speaker, and the two of us are doing a play at the moment. We're playing music as part of this theatre play, and it's called Trad. It's about tradition, and it's about all these issues, you know, keeping language in the country, and, you know, keeping Irishness about ourselves and not getting carried away with modernity. My mother always had it in her mind. She always used to say she wanted me to play the fiddle, you know. She bought me my first fiddle at, I was probably about 7 years of age, but there was no real chance of getting to have lessons in Carrick, you know. But when we moved to Ballyshannon, those opportunities were there. It was a bigger town, you know, and a lot of schools in Ballyshannon. And as you say, the age is a good thing. When the age is right, you know, and kids are ready to start playing, it's a good time to, you know, not be forcing them in too young, I always thought, anyway, you know. And in Ballyshannon, I had the opportunity as well to learn a bit of classical music, so that was a great thing, you know. And that was because of the convent in town. They've always been heavily associated with, you know, the classics and what have you. So they had that going. And then also I had a teacher called Seamus Sweeney, who was teaching traditional music via the Suzuki method, which is kind of funny. You know, he had this interesting concept of teaching traditional through Suzuki, which wouldn't have been very prevalent in Ireland at the time anyway, you know. But that's where I started learning the fiddle, really, and took to it with gusto. There are six in our family, four boys, my poor mother, and we all played music at one time or another. Today, only myself and Angus play music, and Angus was with me on stage for a couple of numbers during the concert in Vicar Street. It's worth pointing out, I suppose, that there were three sets of brothers on the stage at that stage, and the McCarthys, and the Dooleys, and myself and Angus, the McCauleys. And it's a big thing, the family element in music, especially going up, there's a certain amount of rivalry between brothers, you know, and pushing each other into you know, learning things. And did you hear this? Did you hear that? Did you hear the new so-and-so track, you know? Some jigs or reels that someone was playing. Yeah, it's mighty, you know? And trying to be the first to learn them, you know?
My earliest memory of playing music is when I lived with my family in Inishir, which is one of the Aran Islands, the smallest of the Aran Islands. And we had a piano in the house, and I remember trying to pick out bits and pieces of tunes on that, maybe singing with my mother and listening to my dad. My dad used to play the bagpipes in the house, and I used to sit up in the cot and place my hands over my ears and go, "Oh no, Daddy, kyol teen slach." Which, well, he still gives out to me about that one. I've grown to like them a little bit more since. Now, I love coming home and going for walks and getting some fresh air, because I live in Dublin at the moment. I'm based in Dublin for a number of reasons. It's easier to travel from Dublin when you're flying places. This place is very hard to get anywhere from, but it's so beautiful to come down to. And I go for walks up in the mountain and down to the pier, and to bring the dog and get ourselves some exercise. Spend a lot of time sitting in a bus when you're traveling with the lads, so it's lovely to get some exercise when I come home. And sure, where better than down here? The Pobble Moor Lodge in Mahorn Lawn. Agus is thocha snakaegadi vi rodi fachta arvi ni safari na mean tira gus fiin sail roch roig mahan san dov so tregach an ilaanach ta is thocha na skilta san kultur fos mun hipul na hoita sa buintleish agus ha parta gain choma haina midin sa tímpul faun maul parta na buki sanamda agus sos na ilaan choma an parta san. A lot of music around here. There's a very large community of musicians in West Kerry, but But when I come home, I would normally play with my father and my boyfriend Billy, and our friends, our local friends here, Padraig O'Shea and his wife Michelle, and Áine Ní Laoithe, Eileen Ní Chearna, and maybe John Saunders, whoever feels like coming along. We go into Dingle every now and then, but of late we've taken to staying home. It's a great place down the road, and sure, you can walk home.
Going back in my family, my great-grandfather, he was actually a great musician. He played like many instruments, played the accordion and the fiddle and pipes even. His kids even played music, not so much, but more so, they danced more so. And even my own mother, she danced but didn't actually play. But, you know, skipped maybe a few generations, but it was there all the time, you know. There was three of us at home that played music. Myself and my brother Stephen, he played banjo and Shannos dance. And my sister Sharon, she's a fiddle player and a bowron player, you know. So we grew up at home, and there was great encouragement from my mother Mary and my father Jerry, God rest him. We got great encouragement because they used to bring us to, you know what I mean, music classes, you know, we used to go there. And I remember music class it was like a Saturday morning, so, and it was like a couple of miles away from home, so my mother would bring us down, like, and literally wait till we were all finished, even though it could be 3 hours later. My parents, like, would be, you know, in a lot of ways responsible for even meeting the guys in the band, you know, because, you know, we met those at festivals, and we wouldn't have been there only for my own parents, like, brought us there and stuff. So, you know, it's amazing. Even through music, I met my own wife, Anne, who's also a musician as well. The musician and teacher, like, that inspired me the most was Bobby Gardner, you know, a true legend on the accordion, and a great friend now, you know. We often meet up now, even for the chat on accordions and even for a few tunes now and again, you know.
Well, Benny's musical pals would be lads from South Tipperary and North County Waterford. There's a couple of Ryan brothers, Cyril, Pat and Jack, and Wild Men from Up the Mountain, as they'd call it themselves, and great musicians, and had some great nights with them. He also knows a lad local called Des Dillon, who is a great artist, and all of those lads got involved together in a kind of puppet show project, and it's a very interesting thing called Chock a Block, and it's more or less a puppet show, but it's got that extra dimension. It involves Irish music and kind of life-size puppets, and, you know, it involves people playing instruments with the puppets and stuff. It's a great show. So that's what's Benny's outside interest has been for the last while. Des has also been heavily involved with the band, as you'll see from the concert, I suppose, that we did in Vicar Street. a fascinating character. He's a very talented artist as well as the puppet making. He paints, and he did a couple of things for us, for the band. You know, he did a CD cover for us, Up in the Air, and he also did a T-shirt for us one time, which was great fun. It's just us coming on bikes down the road, hear him scaring with instruments flying all over the place. But his greatest talent that we've seen, I suppose, is the life-size puppets that he actually makes himself. And he makes them all in a shed outside his house in Tipperary, in the middle of nowhere. Lovely spot, beautiful spot altogether.
As well as playing with the band, I also manage the band. There's lots of work, of course, even on the business side of music, between telephone calls, emails, between organising flights and making sure tours happen, making sure we get made to be.
Benny is probably the hardest working member of the band, and he's the person everybody goes to when something needs to be sorted out, and he has the patience of a saint. I have never seen Benny lose the plot, and I think if he ever does, he'll have to do it big style, because we've put him through the mill so many times. He's wonderful. He keeps us going, and he's the man behind Danu, as in the business side of things, so he's great.
He organises everything, and he's under a lot of pressure, I'd say, but he still goes out on stage every night and he plays a great show, you know what I mean? I remember being a young fella up in Clancy's in Helvick when the Clancy's moved back from the States first, and up in the sitting room there was an old Bowron, and I remember wondering how to play it, and Fiona showed me how to play it, how to hold the stick, and I got hooked. So I think every day I went up there, instead of riding around on the bicycle with Donald, I'd be inside banging this bar on. I think I drove Liam crack so much that he actually ended up giving me a bar on. And I never looked back from there.
Sometimes when we're performing and Donacha is getting into his baron playing, I can see people turning from the rest of us and just staring at him, mesmerised, because he is this amazing presence on stage.
Donacha and myself have known each other since we were babies. The families have been very close going back. My uncle Bobby Clancy was married to Donacha's aunt Myra Mooney. They were married.
My mother encouraged me to play pipes, and She rang Finbar Fury. So Finbar got me a set of pipes from a maker in Dublin called Johnny Burke. And so I'm still practicing them. As I can remember, there was always music at home. Every Saturday night, he used to look forward to it so much. Vicky Dalton from Medeligo, a great box player, he always had a following of about 16 or 17 musicians. I used to always join in, and I was always made to feel welcome. David Hyland just come down from Ballyduff, and he was my hero. He still is. Because he had this lovely bar on with a Celtic design on it, and I thought it was the coolest thing I ever saw in my life. At those sessions was David, Nicky Power, Mickey Dalton, Mary Daly, Martina McGrath and her sister Shirley, Mick Conroy, Sean Fitz. There used to be at least 16 or 17 musicians every Saturday night. All the musicians of course came to follow Mickey, like, you know. The box was left in Mooney's from one end of the week to the other, and it was always there, so he was always there, his box was always there. He used to never even bring the box home with him. So when I was young, I used to go out and play. And it was great, because I'd sit in the corner and tap along, and I suppose only for that I wouldn't be playing any music.
And do you remember when you got the smart little box?
I remember it, actually, yeah. I remember it. Up beside the television back in Mooney's beside this thing.
Yeah. And you'd be sitting up my lap.
It's hard to believe that now, isn't
it? Yeah, you're used. But I wouldn't like you to do today.
Oh, geez, I wouldn't fancy it either myself.
I'd never used to stand up. And do you remember picking up the bar on and you didn't be left out of anyone who left it out of their hand, you were onto it, weren't you?
Geez, I was. Playing every Saturday night was my favourite night of the week. I couldn't wait for it to come. That went on for about 5 or 6 years anyway. I think eventually that kind of faded out and started playing with musicians my own age. Ciarán, of course, and Fionn McGillicuddy, Donal Clancy, and David Power. And so then we started rambling and heading off on weekends, Kerry and all sorts of places.
I can remember God Almighty playing lovely music, grand music, nice steady music too, you know. And it is the old man. So then they grew up then and kind of, you know, and off playing it. Poor old fellow would lift it home. I wouldn't be able to keep up with him now, you know.
Apart from playing music and working in the bar at home, I also worked as a television sound recordist. And in our spare time, myself and Fionn and Ciarán would sometimes head off and go to old pubs and record local characters all around the Waterford area.
Or perhaps 'Twas a rocket from far Cape Canaveral that was sadly misguided when sent on its way, and the fumes of exhaust that exude from this unit were the cause of the fire in the Carowats Hay. So to all indignation and pulverization, let the whole combination join in the affray, and the sooner the better they mourn from each other. To hell with them now and the Carowats Hay.
In school, I didn't have an interest in anything. I didn't want to go to college. I didn't want to become a farmer. And here I am now making a living out of music, or doing my best.
I was born in Canada, in Calgary, in Alberta. My father was a musician, so the family travelled around a lot. At that time, he was doing a television show in Canada, a music show. Then we moved from there, when I was about 2.5. We moved to New Hampshire. My father was working with Tommy Makin a lot, and that's where Tommy Makin was based. But we used to come back here to Ring every summer. And then we moved back for good, I think in 1983 it was. I was about 7, nearly 8. We moved to a house that my father had bought in the late 60s. He bought it for £800. And it's a little remote house in a place called Keaunawahala. It's right on the side of a cliff. And the views are spectacular. I got to hear a lot of music growing up, obviously because my father was a singer and a musician, and I remember countless musicians coming around to the house when I was a little kid, and I didn't really take that much notice.
I remember one evening, a summer evening, taking Donald for a walk. He was only a little fella, about 8 or 9, and we passed by a thatched cottage down there.
And the half door was open, and there were these notes coming out.
So we stopped in, and there was a session of a group of traditional musicians. I remember Jim Horgan was one of them. He's a flute player who later ended up giving me music lessons. He was inside and he was leading a session around the fire. And I remember going in and sitting on my father's knee and listening to the music.
And it must have imprinted on his mind, because it was shortly afterwards he asked me if I could get him a mandolin. And he started taking lessons. And I was trying to teach him how to play it. I think it was the King of the Fairies. Within 10 minutes, he was playing it far better than I was. So I taught him a couple of licks, like Freight Train, you know, double thumbing. And he just took off into the blues, and John Renburn became his hero. And
I'm not on tour with Danu. I'm in New York, and it's great because I'm kept very busy. There's some great musicians there. Indeed, my wife plays. Her name is Mary Rafferty. She used to play with the group Cherish the Ladies. And her father, Mike, is a fabulous flute player. He's originally from Ballinakil in County Galway. So the three of us, we go off and we do some gigs when I'm free from Danu. Still get to spend a lot of time back home with the band, usually before and after a tour, say in Ireland or in Europe. I'd come back and spend some days at home where I grew up. It's great to meet my family, and I get to come back probably 4 or 5 times a year, maybe more, which is great. And so many people I know, Irish people over in New York, they might get to see their families once every couple of years, so I consider myself very lucky. The best of both worlds.
The first tour I did with Danu was a tour of the UK, and I think I had done one gig with them previous to that in Ballyduff in County Waterford, which was amazing. It was 10 days with the group, I think. I had all the words laid out in front of me on the floor.
Look in your pockets and count what you've lost. Grey skies and pebbles and shadows and moss. You got standing in doorways with nothing to say. Petaled in June, but two broken wings lie down.
And we went off to the UK, and the first gig we played was in Manchester in this wonderful venue called the Lowry. And well, God, it was a great experience. It was fantastic. But when I remember the beginning of that tour and the end of the tour, the difference was unbelievable.
The girl's voice really fits in so well. I love that song that she does, that which won an award, by the way. The Tommy Sands song, The County Down.
When you're out walking and there's no one near you, but a voice keeps calling.
Love on the piece of geisha fish radio, agus near the scumpy one can start you be a guest. Achmar Horlisha is some BBC V guest, agus be chlor my carding of yon, agus V County Down a Heintke, agus niig sandoche. Shabar Grupa Danu, aha animihe lahaig on Grupa is far a gradmikol BBC though in near to be the car. Agus Nachmoger, it's the legge. Agus Homersel, Dilund, and me fiora. Agus vi an hour on the County Down animihe homa, or an hour on is far homa the Tommy Sands.
You'll hear me calling. Come on home.
When it comes to rehearsing, we'd all gather down in Ring, which is where some of the lads are from, in Waterford. And it's lovely to arrive down there on a nice bright day and catch up with the lads. There might be a few weeks since we all last saw each other.
We know we're going to get a lot of work done. It's tried and tested now and it works really well. We've recorded 4 albums here, and actually we've recorded 5 albums here.
We might go into Mooney's and have a session and maybe go over some tunes or practice a new song, something like that. Long the hill, agus crack. Agus carry Terry Ultocha, being Anne, not all their fad, being on time come Lan. Agus Billy Cushing, Alan Choma, agus Dean Ella. She'd long the hind, agus long the crack, so being on time come Lan.
Queen of Na, Visharon is Loyhook, or if Gael at the Khan, only 19 years old.
Me? You see some man in all.
Mm-hmm.
Me had to be in. It's not any begin at 19-year-old.
Oh, man. I guess cut a Harleen.
No, he's a man that just said to snow. I married a young one at 19-year-old.
Was he sick of heaving her fat?
We he not that auntie didn't know her. Near a lech Harleen now.
It's often a good thing for us when we're finished rehearsing to go down to Mooney's pub, you know, and play some of the stuff we're after doing. And playing it for friends of ours, you know, to see what they think. Because you know that if they don't like it, they won't tell you.
before even Donal came back into the band, you know, we had been recording in his home, you know, in the studio, which is just beside his parents' house.
We know Liam as Donal's dad, you know, but when he kind of starts into telling stories about life on the road with the Clancys and his life in general, it's amazing hearing someone talk about, you know, when he was having a night out with Bob Dylan and, you know, or going over and shaking JFK's hand after doing a concert for him.
They're making a great career out of it. And it's their life. They're totally involved and totally committed. And you can see that shining through.
Yeah, now that we're a bit older, a few years down after 5 albums now, is it? It's funny, like, people have said, like, oh, you've matured a lot now, you've quietened down a lot, but it's funny, inside you still, in our playing, there's just as much youth and vigour and energy in our playing. Despite the, maybe the, how tired we'd be after travelling.
A few heavy years of touring. I'm actually only 18 at the moment.
We're often travelling all over America for, you know, the 5-6 week periods we do. I think we tend to be down more towards the 4 weeks, which is nice these days. And then you'd arrive back and you'd be playing somewhere like Dungarvan, the Park Hotel, and that's the homecoming, you know.
Your family and your friends and you have all the younger people seem to come out for that gig. I don't know why. It's great. You practically know everybody that's there in the audience.
It's like a rock concert. And the amazing thing is that it's not old fuddy-duddies or anybody, it's young screaming girls who are out there, you know. It's, they're really going for it, and that's wonderful to see.